Well, welcome to church. Good morning and Happy New Year. Come on, we can do better than that. Happy New Year. Well, it does seem like about a year ago, we were actually at this very same spot. And my phone reminded of me that this week when it brings up all those photos from like last year and then 2 years ago and then 3 years ago. And you start to see how old you are and how young your kids were. And you're reminded that time is progressing. But it is good to take stock of where we've been and where we're going. My wife and I were actually talking about that this past week as we were reflecting back. Gosh, a year ago, it was the end of 2019, and we were really hopeful for what 2020 would bring. And then 2020 happened. So are we hopeful for 2021 to be better than 2020? I know I am, because 2020 did not work out the way that I wanted it to be. And so we don't put our hope in the calendar. We don't put our hope in resolutions. We don't even put our hope in a football team. And as your pastor, young Keegan, who's a big Bears fan, I should caution you for a false hope about today's game. Notice I'm wearing green. Okay, let there be no mistake about who my favorite team is on the football field. I know that was like mixed in this crowd for sure. But it was meant to be. So we don't put our hope in the calendar. We don't put our hope in jobs or relationships. We put our hope in the living Jesus Christ, right? Hope has a name, and his name is Jesus. It's not in a number in 2021. I did a little research on what the rest of the world thinks, you know, when the calendar turns, and I found this really cool study on Psychology Today. They came up with a study called the Broken Promises Effect, and I was really intrigued. I read about it. It's actually an effect on people around this time of year that leads to heightened levels of despair and hopelessness. And I thought, I better keep reading because, you know, New Year, Christmas, hope should be at the highest level. And apparently it's not, according to this broken promises effect. And here's how it works. Unfortunately, Christmas comes and goes, and socialization ends, families move on, and around this time of year, people no longer believe the promises of peace, goodwill, comfort, and joy that they were experiencing around Christmas time. And the problem is that they've placed those promises, they've placed that hope of those promises horizontally. They've placed them in other sinful people. They haven't placed them in the sinless, unfading, imperishable name that is Jesus Christ. And the study went on to report that they reported this: the New Year celebration actually presents a rise in suicide that overshadows the Christmas lull. As the New Year's arises, individuals may feel overwhelmed at the thought of having to make it through another day that is fraught with desperation and feelings of hopelessness and emptiness. My heart goes out to these people. They're putting their hope in the false hope. They're putting their hope horizontally in the things that they cannot please them. The article concluded with this, though, and actually it's an impressive truth. Hope is a powerful tool, and it is the tool that helps people move from despair to belief. Now, they were applying it horizontally, and they were encouraging people to be the hope of other people, but we apply it vertically. Jesus is the hope of other people that brings people from despair to belief. And what better place to find hope than in this book, God's Word, right? We hold high God's Word. And more importantly, from the apostle of hope, Peter. So we're going to be in 1 Peter 1, 3 through 5. And before we open the text, let's just bow our heads in a word of prayer. Father in heaven, we look to you for all of the hope that we need. We pray at this very moment that you're sowing seeds of hope in the name of Jesus as you open hearts before the word goes out, as you provide comfort through your word, and perhaps you provide a challenge to those that think differently than what your word says. Open our ears, open our hearts, and open our minds to receive all that it is that you have for us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, open your Bibles. We're going to be in 1 Peter 1, 3 through 5. And while you're turning there, I'm going to set the text up because we need some context to who Peter is writing to. Many of you can call to mind the Apostle Peter himself. I'm sure he was a very emotional individual. I'm sure you can call to mind many different things that happened in his life as he walked with Jesus. But more importantly, it's the audience that the Lord is asking him to write to. We see it in right there in verse 1. If you're already there, you can just slide your finger up to the top there. We're writing to the elect exiles of the dispersion. And then he lists five areas, which today would be Turkey area. This is Asia Minor. Interestingly, these five areas, other than the southern portion of Galatia, Paul was prohibited from ministering to. So this letter is the only recorded evidence of God's word getting to these Roman colonies. And it was preserved for us to take something from. And that's why we're going to unpack some of the context here. So three things were happening during this time. This letter was written, as best we can understand, 63 or 64. It was during the time of Nero. And many of you know, Roman Emperor Nero was known for incredible persecution of Christians, crucifying them upside down, putting them into the Roman Colosseum to be attacked and hunted by lions. These are many of the different famous components of Nero. But what we got to unpack a little bit before when this letter was written is Emperor Claudius. And Claudius was an emperor when there was great prosperity for Rome, and the Roman Empire was expanding like crazy. And so we have two events that actually took place under Claudius's reign from 40 to 54. And that was the colonization of Rome. And how they did that was they took Roman people from the epicenters of Rome, well colonized, and they sent them out into these territories. And the idea was to infuse culture, to infuse language, to infuse belief systems, pagan belief systems, the Roman pagan belief system. And they would infuse these people in these surrounding newly conquered territories to Romanize that area. So Gentiles were being told to leave the city of Rome in droves to go colonize these five specific regions. It's well documented in extra-biblical materials. The other thing that happened in 49 under Claudius was the dispersion. That's why this word is capitalized. This is a well-known edict under Claudius that the Jews were causing riots in Rome, and they had to leave. And so he kicked all the Jews out of Rome. Whether you were a believing Christian Jew or you were just under Judaism, you had to go. And so we have an audience of Gentiles, we have an audience of Jews in these five regions. Now the Romans, they tolerated Judaism, but Christianity was unique, and it was growing, and it was kind of an unknown. And so in Rome, you had to have an approved religion, and Christianity was not an approved religion. So everyone who professed the name of Jesus, who professed Christianity as it was first named in Acts 11, was actually being persecuted just because they were being called Christian, because they followed Christ. They were being persecuted socially. They were being bullied in their homes and marketplaces. And then later, when Nero, they were actually being persecuted because of the government. So we have a heavy dose of persecution, some of it social, most of it social. And it was starting in Rome, and it was also dispersing. And Peter's writing from Rome, and he's seeing this firsthand, and he's saying, I've got to get a letter out to these people to encourage them. And really, that's where we pick up. So let's turn our attention to the text, starting in verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. This is a great text. As we were singing one of the worship songs, I'm like, I think that song was written because of this text. We're going to unpack three big things in here, three big truths. They're actually doctrines of salvation that are hiding in this text that Peter writes, that Paul agrees with, and James and John also write about. So get ready. We're going to be flipping around in the Bible just a little bit. Time to turn some pages, time to open God's word. But if we get nothing out of this, we need to know that as born-again Christians, we are to give all praise and all glory to the Lord for his abundant mercy in the works that he's done for us. It says it right here. Paul opens his very first thing. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's his opening salvo to persecuted Christians. Praise should be flowing from our lips through the indwelling of our spirit, through the new birth, which gives us hope, inheritance, and salvation through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We are always to be praising and thanking God. If you take nothing from this message, if you carry nothing with you into 2021, keep in the front of your mind that we are to be praising our holy God because of his great mercy all the days of our lives. That's the hope that we have, and we can take that to the bank. We're going to unpack three truths. The first one is, I have hope because of the means of my salvation. We can find this in the first part of verse 3, specifically here. Look at the text. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again. Well, there's some interesting things in there. We're going to spend a couple of minutes unpacking just that small phrase. According to his great mercy, let's start there. Great. What does this word great mean? Well, it can mean two things. It can mean a lot of, like great in an amount, but it can also be great in terms of the quality of the mercy, in this case, the quality of what you're getting. And Peter here is definitely talking about both. The mercy that our God gives us is far better than the mercy that any human can give another human. The mercy that our God gives us is far greater and far reaching in the past and forward than any human can give in the finite amount of time that they have. And it has a great amount of abundance to it. There's a lot of it. That's why we sing what we sing. There's no depth that you can't conquer, Lord, because his mercy is so great, it will come after you. So we have a lot of mercy, and we have better mercy. Now, this word mercy, I just have to highlight for you, because we think of mercy more like what Paul says, right? I need to be given mercy because I don't deserve the great things that I've done, right? This mercy, this word, if it were reverse translated into Hebrew, would be chesed, which is more like love. It's a loving kind mercy. It's a loving kindness that comes from it. For God so loved the world, for God so had mercy on the world, you could easily interchange the two here. It's a great love. It's a great compassion. It's a great overflowing and abundant mercy, which would be extremely welcoming to the ears of people dispersed, being told to leave Rome, being kicked out if you're a Jew. I need to receive the fact that God's love and mercy for me extends far beyond that which I'm even capable of, you know, of understanding, even of myself. Is there a reason for that mercy that allows us to be born again? No. It's God's sovereign choice. And that's the second part of this. If you're taking notes, write this down. Only God grants the second birth to enter the kingdom. And so we praise him. And here it is in the text. He has caused us to be born again. Now, this born again word, I'm sure some of you who know your Bible well are already thinking, well, I've heard that word before. That's in John 3. I think Jesus had that interaction with Nicodemus, right? I should be born again. I should be born again. Paul also wrote about it. So this word is a little bit different. It's of the same derivative, but for Paul or for Peter, it's just a little bit different, meaning begat again. It's a different word because we're not looking at the conversion component of things. I was, and now I'm new, although that's a piece of it. But Peter's hitting, I'm born again. Like, I'm begotten again. This is a second birth. There was no past. My past was dead. Now I'm alive in the spirit, and I'm only looking forward. It's a future-looking word that he's using here. It's only used twice in the entire Bible, and it's in this passage, in this text, and again in verse 23, which we're going to look at in just a little bit. So it's very specific for us to understand. This is the doctrine of regeneration. This is a doctrine that's key in salvation, that only God provides the spiritual life with which we're given to praise him. Warren Grudem defined regeneration like this: the act of God awakening spiritual life within us, bringing us from spiritual death to spiritual life. That's a pretty good definition, but I came up with one on my own. God's unconditional choice, whereby he infuses the Spirit to awake us and to see and to hear him. There's a lot that happens when God infuses you with his Holy Spirit. The Trinity is entirely viewable here. In fact, Peter himself notes three in one in verse 2. It originates from the Father. It's made possible through the blood of Jesus Christ and the resurrection. And it's affected in us by the Spirit. One God, triune, all working together in the regeneration of our souls, of our spirits, giving us new life. Peter, James, and John all agree. You can look at James 1:18, John 1. In fact, let's turn there. Here comes the beginning of having your fingers ready on your Bible. We're going to John 1, 12 and 13. This is in the beginning, John's gospel, the word becoming flesh, and he's very specific here, starting in verse 12. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. God births you. If you were born of flesh, you didn't even make the decision to birth yourself, did you? You weren't around when your parents decided to have children. You weren't around when they conceived you. You only showed up, by the will of others into your flesh. You didn't name yourself. You didn't do any of that. You can't unbirth yourself. The Lord uses, the scripture uses this analogy of birth to impart this newness that you and I had nothing to do with. It came entirely from God. When you understand that, when we receive that, how can we not praise a holy God for choosing us? He chose me. He picked me up from where I was and made me new in his spirit. All praise to him. He told us he was going to do this. And some of you who know your Bible are already thinking about Ezekiel 36 and 37, right? For those that don't know, he wrote to Ezekiel, "A new heart I will give you, and a new spirit I will put within you. I will take out of your flesh the heart of stone, and I will give you a heart of flesh." He continues in 37, verse 14, "I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live." It's new life that comes solely from the Lord. He told us he was going to do it, and he did it. He did it through the blood, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and through the indwelling of the Spirit. It's a perfect picture of the Trinity at work in our lives. So what does regeneration actually do? What does this mean? What can we take from it? Well, it does a couple of things. We're going to hit two. It allows us to hear the gospel. We just sang, "Give us eyes to see and ears to hear." We pray it all the time. We want people to have soft hearts to receive what God is already willing to give them. We want them to hear God's word. We want this scripture to come alive. That can't happen without God's infused spirit in the person. It just can't. Peter actually tells us more about this. Just skip across the page to verse 23. And he writes, "Since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of now imperishable seed, through the living and abiding word of God." The word, to the bottom of 25, "and this word is the good news that was preached to you." Those that have regenerated spirits are even allowed to hear God's word. More than that, they delight in it. They rejoice in hearing it. Have you ever read God's word to somebody who you weren't sure was a Christian, and you got a sense that they're like, "Man, that kind of hurt their ears." Yeah, they can't hear it. They can't receive it. And then there's people, like a lot of you, when I read God's word, you're like, "Give me more. I can't wait to hear what God's word says next. I have to open the Bible. I want to read it every morning and every night." Psalm 1 says that. "I delight in his law, and I meditate on it day and night." That's because you have the same spirit that wrote this word, that raised the Lord from the dead, that's living in you, and it needs to be fed from God's word that comes from regeneration, that comes from the Father into us. So we should be praising him for all of that. Two things that this means that you weren't a Christian all your life. Don't ever let me hear from you, "How long have you been a Christian?" I've been a Christian all my life. You haven't. This scripture proves it. You were not born a Christian. Even if you were baptized as a baby, you just weren't. You were born to death. Right? Yeah, and so some of you are nodding. Some of you are like, "What is he talking about? I was baptized as a baby. I was actually baptized as a baby. I was baptized again as an adult when I realized what was going on." And that's important. Titus 3:5, which is a scripture often used to justify water baptism as the rebirth, But it does exactly the opposite. You should mark it in your book. I'll read a little bit from here. He saved us not because of works done by his righteousness, but according to his own mercy by the washing of regeneration and the renewal of the Spirit. It's not by works done in righteousness. The baptism itself doesn't save you. The regeneration of the Spirit saves you. The baptism is an effect of that. It's the first act of obedience that we do. That's why when you hear stories of baptisms and we play them out all the time, how were you before the Lord entered your life? Well, I was this way. And how are you after the Lord entered your life? And you hear these great stories of transformation because the newness that was infused by the Father is coming to life in this person. The Word came alive. 9 times out of 10, the person in the tank goes, well, I read the Bible. Good. I mean, that's the first thing for sure that you should be doing. But it's because the Bible didn't mean anything to me before. Now that I have the Spirit in me, I can read the Bible and I can get something from it, and it's feeding me. That's a great testimony from the baptismal tank. Another one I heard recently is, well, I see people differently. Yes, you do. You hear things differently and you see things differently. This is the infusion of the Spirit at work in you. Praise the Lord when that happens. And praise the Lord when you see it happening in somebody else and encourage them in that direction. Keep going in that direction. That is a good thing. The last thing that regeneration means is you can't lose your salvation. We need to take hold of this promise. You were not given your salvation. It was given to you by the Lord, and you can't get rid of it. It stays with you because of the power of the Lord. So own that. How encouraging must that have been to these people who are being sent out, kicked out of their homes, told to go colonize somewhere else, that just because they're leaving Rome or the epicenter or the temple, which Jews were really hold to, they need a geography, right? You can't lose this. The Lord's with you the whole way. So encouraging. Okay, the last thing for note takers as we close on point one is the same Spirit who raised Jesus dwells in me. We've hit this a little bit. But the birth is a result of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Here's what Peter says. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. These prepositions are tricky. This is a really tricky verse. Throughs and twos, and they're all intermixed and so on and so forth. But through, in this case, it either is a portal, you're going through a door, or it means by means of. In this case, dia, the Greek means it's a by means of the resurrection. The resurrection of Jesus Christ paved the way so that we can actually receive the new Spirit in us. It couldn't happen before Jesus was raised from the dead. Paul writes in Colossians 1:18, he is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. That firstborn word means prototokos. That's the Greek for prototype. That's where we come from. So now that he's born from the dead, the rest of us can follow. Regeneration happens because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Paul also says this in Romans 6:4. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in the newness of life. The resurrection of Jesus Christ gives us the birth. Paul continues in 8:11. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. This is great hope. I was trying to think through an example of how all of this works together, because we've been chosen. We're going to hit the adoption next. We're going to come into the Lord's family next, and we're guarded and protected. If you get nothing else, we've been chosen, we're adopted into his family, and we are protected and guarded in our faith all the way into our inheritance. And I couldn't think of one example. Well, I did think of one example that captured all these things, and it came up to be little orphan Annie. That's what I thought of. I was like, wow, Annie actually kind of hits on all of these things. Go figure. So little Annie, recalling in your heads right now, she was in despair, right? It's a hard not life, right? You can all are singing the song in your head right now, even as I just say the title, because we're so used to it. But she lived in despair. She had no parents. She had no love. She had to work. It was horrible the way that she lived. She didn't have anything. But when Daddy Warbucks and his people decided to do this whole orphan thing, they chose her. Why was she different than anyone else? Why didn't she choose? They choose Lily or Mary or Martha. Pick a other orphan. Well, Annie was the one that was chosen. Not by anything she did. She was picked up out of her destitute, brought to Daddy Warbucks, and later she was actually adopted. And now she lives, like, talk about rags to riches. That's our story, spiritually speaking. We've gone from rags to riches, from death to life. We're going to pick up more on Annie towards the end. Let's look at the next section of Scripture here, starting at the end of verse 3 through the end of verse 4. I have hope because of the results of my salvation. Salvation gives us results. Let's read the text. And as I read, I'm going to stop. I want you guys to circle two words as we go through this, just to highlight these. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to, circle two, a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. To, circle two, an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. We have two specific joys that Peter's highlighting here, a living hope and an inheritance. This is the beginning and the end. He's putting a blocker on the full spectrum of what the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ gives us. He gives us hope and he gives us inheritance, salvation from our past and our future. Since Jesus was the firstborn among us, among many brothers, we now have a hope for the future under the authority of Christ. And he speaks of inheritance, so we must be heirs. And by heirs, we are children, right? Titus 3:7, so that being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. All right, we got to turn our Bibles the other direction now. 1 John 3. Flip over there. First John 3, starting in verse 2, beloved, we are God's children now. And what we will be has not yet appeared, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. We are children of God because we are reconciled to God. While we were still sinners, we were reconciled to Christ, Paul writes. So now, as Christians being reconciled to Christ, we are actually ambassadors of Christ. The old is gone. Behold, the new has come. Now you have the ministry of reconciliation that you must share with others. Because you're a child of God, you're adopted into his family. You're an heir. We have all of the inheritance that comes from Jesus. We get to share in that as a brother. In fact, Jesus calls the disciples brothers, and we are that too. A proper ambassador focuses on the living hope for our future. So while I was planning for this message, I thought, I wonder what the world thinks about, you know, hope. What are some top quotes in the world that people, like, hold on to? I found a few of them. They kind of fell under some interesting headings. Hope in yourself. Arthur Miller, some of you might, older people like me might know him from Death of a Salesman. He was the author of that. He writes, I think it's a mistake to ever look for hope outside of oneself. And here's one for you younger kids from Mariah Carey. When you feel like hope is gone, look inside you and be strong, and you'll finally see the truth that the hero lies in you. That's false teaching. It's funny, but it's false. The hero doesn't lie in you. It's not of you. It's otherworldly in you. Hope is not in ourself, and hope is not in our dreams. Aristotle wrote, hope is a waking dream. Jonas Salk, he's actually the famous doctor who invented the polio vaccine. For some reason, he gets quoted on hope. And he writes, hope lies in dreams, in imagination, and in the courage of those who dare to make dreams reality. Dreams are great, but dreams fade. Dreams become unrealized. Our Lord is unfading. Lastly, the category is hope in the world. And this is one that captures a lot of people in the Western culture. And there's a secret word here at the end of this quote from Alfred Tennyson. Hope smiles from the threshold of the year to come, whispering, it will be happier. And there it is, the chase for happiness in the world. If I just do this addition to my house, I'll be happier. If I just get a new car, I'll be happier. I mean, the list goes on, doesn't it? The list just keeps going. There isn't a hope in the world that a moth or rust or a thief can't break in and steal, right? I like how Warren Wiersbe puts this, his definition of a living hope. A living hope is one that has life in it and therefore can give life to us. Because it has life, it grows and becomes greater and more beautiful as time goes on. Time destroys most hopes. They fade and then die. But the passing of time only makes a Christian's hope that much more glorious. That makes sense. If you've got hope next to inheritance, and you know that your inheritance in heaven is far greater than anything on this earth, and the closer you get every day to that inheritance, your hope is increasing, not decreasing. That's a perfect definition by Wiersbe. Every day we get closer to receiving the glorification, the inheritance from the Lord, we're that much closer to the beauty that he's promised us. This is so important to grasp from this text. Peter called this hope, he linked the two, right? Hope and inheritance. That's what verse 4 is all about. As children of the King, we share in this inheritance in his glory. If then children, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ. Cannot overlook the importance of this heritage to the Jewish audience in particular. They were well-versed in their inheritance through the Abrahamic covenant. They knew that they had were supposed to receive an inheritance. Even in Psalm 16, you can read it, I have a beautiful inheritance. It was promised from even when the Psalms were writing. The Jews were very, very clear that as the chosen nation, they were to receive an inheritance. And Peter uses that word specifically here, as did Paul in his writings. And the description of that inheritance is really important. We see three words, imperishable. Imperishable pertains to being impervious to corruption or decay. This word has to do with the substance of the inheritance. It cannot diminish. You were perishable when you were born. Now in new life, you're imperishable, as Peter reminded us in verse 23. The other word, undefiled. This has to do with being, it's not capable of being polluted. It will remain pure. Sin has no bearing on this inheritance. So we've got purity, a lack of corruption or diminishment, and then lastly, it's unfading. It keeps its pristine character. It doesn't lose its brightness. It retains its full color and its full character, like a flower that never fades. Inheritance is a beautifully permanent thing. Going back to Annie. Annie was chosen. She went to live with Daddy Warbucks. She lived, well, she's the only child of Daddy Warbucks, adopted now, so she gets that inheritance too. She's the sole heir. More importantly, while she's living on this earth, she has that, she's the heiress to the Warbucks fortune. She has another thing. She's got Punjab. Punjab is the protector of Daddy Warbucks. She gets all of the resources of protection while she's in Daddy Warbucks' care. And we get all of the protections from the Lord as his children. We have protections that guard us from the enemy on the outside, and we have protections on the inside that keep us in his family until the day that the glory is revealed. And that's our last point for today. I have hope because of the permanence of my salvation. I have assurance while I'm on this earth, and I have assurance for the glorification that will come to me through the salvation, through the blood and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Let's read verse 5. Who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Okay, there's three things in here we have to look at. God's power, faith, and salvation being revealed. We're going to unpack each of those briefly here with the time remaining. God guards us. He protects us from Satan's attacks. Peter experienced this. It's recorded in Luke 22. Many of you can probably recall the fact that that was something that Jesus prayed for him to come through. Peter, Satan demanded to sift you like wheat, but the Lord prayed for him. This is a passive voice, better read, as opposed to who by God's power are being guarded, who are constantly being guarded, who are being guarded all the time. It's continuous. It's a continuous voice. It's continuous for the born-again Christian. Many of you read the Psalms, I know, and you go there for encouragement, and you go there to find words of encouragement in the Psalms for protection. If you read Psalm 16 or 46 or 77, or recently last year, the men dove into Psalm 91. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. Every time you're drawn to the Psalms looking for refuge, you're coming under the umbrella of care that the Lord has provided you through the salvation. You are praying. How beautiful. These Psalms were written 1,000 years before Christ. Yet they still affirm Christ's protection given to us through his death and resurrection. This is just amazing. God's power protects us from what would cause us to fall away from him and the salvation he provided in Christ. God's power does not protect us from trials. You're going to go through trials. You're going to be tempted. God's power is in coming through those trials, stepping away from those temptations. That's God's power manifested through faith. Faith is that agency at that point. The sin that's being protected here is unbelief. That's the sin that we're being protected from. That's what he's guarding you from. Unbelief that may lead to something so bad as apostasy. Sin in general is just a lack of faith. And this can be kind of small, right? Every time we think in this world we want to take back the wheel, thanks God, I appreciate you bringing in that deal, I'm going to close it from here. Thanks Lord for finding me that contractor, you know, I'm going to design my house from here. Thanks Lord. Like we start to take over the things that he's provided for us. Don't do that. We shouldn't be doing that. He's still the one who's protecting us and walking us through day in and day out. Do not move into a lack of faith because we're trying to wrestle back control from the one who gave it to us, from the one who gave us our salvation. And then this, God secures us in saving faith. We cannot escape. Our faith is from God, and God's power is manifested in the preservation of that faith. No one says, well, I've lost my faith. No one who was actually saved from the beginning. The I walked away from the Lord is not possible for a regenerate soul. It's not possible. They weren't there in the first place. And that might be hard to hear because some of you are probably thinking of some people that have said that to you. I know I am, and I pray for them. I pray that their hearts would be softened so that they could hear God's word and be regenerate. And then when that happens, stand up and give praise to the Lord for saving them from themselves. God's going to bring all of this into our future salvation. Our salvation is already and not yet. We have been saved from our past, but we haven't actually gotten there yet. Unless Jesus comes while I'm standing here today or sometime in this year when we're all alive, we haven't actually gotten to the finish line of salvation. That is still coming. That's the promise of the future. Peter talks in this apocalyptic language right here. He's saying that the salvation, it's ready to be revealed in the last time. It's already been done. The work of Christ on the cross is complete. That's why Jesus said, tetelestai, it is finished. From that moment, our salvation and our inheritance in heaven was already laid up for us. The only thing we're waiting for is for the Father to decide when enough is enough. That's it. That's what's going to be revealed in the last time, but salvation is complete. We can live in that assurance while we wait for the final step of that to happen. Paul wrote in Ephesians 1, 13 and 14, "In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it, to the praise of his glory." That's what Paul's saying right there. You have the guarantee of the Holy Spirit in you. That's why you've been given this indwelling, so that you know with confidence that you're going to heaven. That is not a prideful thing. It's actually a humbling thing. I can't do this on my own. The Lord gave it to me, and I give him praise for it. So we want to bless the Lord for all that he's done in those three things. I'm going to close. I'm going to read over you Psalm 103. And as I read this, you may follow along if you'd like. You may close your eyes and just listen. You may stand, you may kneel, you may sit, you may put your hands in your head, you may figure out what it is that yearns in your heart in order to bless the Lord. But I want you to listen for these three things that we just talked about. They're in this psalm. New birth, regeneration, adoption, glorification, assurance of our salvation. David wrote this psalm 1,000 years before Jesus Christ, 3,021 years since us. And that truth is right here. It's still for us today. Psalm 103. "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all our iniquity, who heals all our diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with the steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. For he knows our frame, remembers that we are but dust. As for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower of the field. For the wind passes over it, and it is gone, and its place knows it no more. But the steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, and his righteousness to his children's children, to those who keep his covenant and remember to do his commandments. The Lord has established his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom rules over all. Bless the Lord, O you his angels, you mighty ones who do his word, obeying the voice of his word. Bless the Lord, all his hosts, his ministers who do his will. Bless the Lord, all his works in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul."